Today we'll be talking about age-related macular degeneration, of which we'll be covering the overview, pathophysiology as well as classification, risk factors, definition, types of AMD, management considerations, as well as current clinical research. Age-related macular degeneration, otherwise known as AMD, is the third leading cause of blindness worldwide and the first in developed countries. It is a common cause of vision loss in patients above age of 50, and it accounts for 8.7% of blindness worldwide. Prevalence is expected to increase due to aging population and is expected to reach about 288 million in 2020. So for the pathophysiology, it can be divided into dry AMD as well as wet AMD. Dry AMD includes features such as drusen, lipofuscin accumulation, as well as retinal pigment epithelial atrophy or geographical atrophy. Wet AMD can be divided into choroidal neovascularization, otherwise known as CNV, polypoidal choroidal vascularization, PCV, or retinal angiomatous proliferation, RAP. CNV includes features such as drusen, lipofuscin accumulation, CNV development, exudation, hemorrhage, as well as scarring or even a disiform scar. PCV has classically absence of drusen, is more common in Asians, with features of a grape-like polyp, as well as extensive exudation and hemorrhage. RAP is more similar to CNV, with presence of drusen, lipofuscin accumulation. It has three stages, starting off as an intraretinal pathology, followed by a subretinal, as well as finally developing into a CNV. It usually has intraretinal and subretinal blood, as well as fluid, and finally turning into a scarring. So definitions. The classical CNV is defined as early hyperfluorescence with well-defined lacy pattern with progressive leakage at the late stage. Occult CNV is a late leakage of undetermined origin or fibrovascular pigment epithelial detachment. Definitions of location for a subfovea is involving center of the foveola. Juxtafoveal lesions are located between 1 to 199 microns from the center of foveola. Extrafoveal lesions are at least 200 microns from the center of a foveola, and this is based on the definition from the Macular Photocoagulation Study Group. So the risk factors includes aging, smoking, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, obesity, as well as family history. Symptoms include gradual or acute blurring of vision, presence of a scotoma centrally, as well as metamorphopsia or even micropsia. And complications include breakthrough hemorrhage or macular scarring. So this slide shows the features of dry AMD, which includes drusen as well as geographical atrophy. So in the upper left picture, it shows presence of intermediate to large soft drusens centered around the macula, and is shown in the optical coherence tomography on the upper right corner. On the lower left corner, it shows an area about 1.5 disc diameter centered on the fovea of geographical atrophy with retinal pigment epithelial atrophy, as evidenced on optical coherence tomography on the lower right picture. This slide shows the presence of a wet AMD. Upper column shows choroidal neovascularization. Lower shows polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. So the upper left picture shows a presence of subretinal blood as well as area of exudation and elevation, which is confirmed on the optical coherence tomography on the upper right picture. In the lower left picture, there's presence of extensive exudation, but with minimal amount of drusen, and is also confirmed on the left lower photo of the optical coherence tomography. This is the fundus fluorescein angiogram showing the features of a classical choroidal neovascularization, of which in the early frame, there's a presence of a lacy hyperfluorescent well-defined pattern that results in late leakage at the later frames. This shows occult choroidal neovascularization, of which in the early frames, there's a stippled, ill-defined hyperfluorescence that leaks in the late frames with no definite source of leakage. This is the fundus fluorescein angiogram on the left side, as well as the indocyanine green angiogram on the right side for polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. So this is the slide showing the fundus fluorescein angiogram as well as indocyanine green angiogram for polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. So on the right side, there's presence of polyps as evidenced by the arrows, which are the grape-like structures suggestive of polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy. It's the fundus fluorescein angiogram of a retinal angiomatous proliferation, which shows presence of pinpoint hyperfluorescence at the end of the blood vessel, as evidenced by the arrow, which suggests presence of anastomosis between the intraretinal as well as the subretinal region. For the management, dry AMD management includes conservative treatment, low vision aids, as well as Arrett's formula supplements. Wet AMD includes 3 consecutive monthly intravitreal dosing, followed by pro-renata treatment or treat and extend. Currently, there are 3 medications available on the market. The first one is bevacizumab, 1.25 mg in 0.05 ml, as an off-label treatment, but is contraindicated in patients with previous ischemic heart disease or cerebral vascular accidents. The next one would be ranibizumab, 0.5 mg in 0.05 ml, and finally, the newest drug, 2 mg in 0.05 ml, which is aflibercept. For polypoidal choroidal vasculopathy, both subfoveal and juxtafoveal lesions require combination therapy of anti-vascular endothelial growth factor, otherwise known as anti-VEGF, as well as photodynamic therapy or PDT. Extrafoveal lesions require a combination therapy of anti-VEGF and focal laser. So complications of anti-VEGF treatment includes ocular and systemic. Ocular complications include subconjunctival hemorrhage, vitreous hemorrhage, retinal detachment, endophthalmitis, lens touch resulting in cataract, raised intraocular pressure, as well as central retinal artery occlusion. Systemic factors include stroke, acute myocardial infarction, hypertension, as well as gastrointestinal bleed. Landmark clinical trials for AMD includes MARINA as well as ANCHOR, which are for minimally classic or occult, as well as classic choroidal neovascularization respectively. So MARINA showed that there's a mean increase in visual acuity in the patients receiving at least 0.3 mg or 0.5 mg of ranibizumab versus those without, with a decrease of 10.4 letters in those with sham injection. ANCHOR showed a visual acuity improvement from baseline 8.1 to 10.7 letters versus a mean decline of 9.8 letters in patients receiving PDT. For PCV, the landmark trial is the Everest study, which shows vertiporfin combined with ranibizumab or alone was superior to ranibizumab monotherapy in achieving complete polyp regression. Mean change in best corrected visual acuity was 10.9 letters for patients receiving vertiporfin plus ranibizumab, or 7.5 letters for patients receiving only vertiporfin, and 9.2 for patients receiving ranibizumab. Comparison of the bevacizumab versus ranibizumab was done via the CAT trial, which had results for 2 years. It showed gain in visual acuity was similar for both drugs, and there was no inferiority. Patients with one or more systemic serious adverse events was higher with bevacizumab than ranibizumab. Thank you.